Zoning Commission. We're going to take a roll call. Commissioner Nancy Golden?
Present.
Commissioner Leonard Spreaker?
Present.
Commissioner Greg Loper?
Present.
Commissioner Sean Hutchinson?
Present.
Commissioner Bill Lewis?
Present.
Commissioner Jay Otlawski?
Present.
Commissioner Jeff Nelson?
Present.
And I am Commissioner Lee Strickman. We're going to go through an opening statement. This commission is composed of Peoria citizens who have been appointed by the City Council to serve on the commission as a civic responsibility without compensation. Our duty is to study and review planning and zoning issues within the city of Peoria and then forward our recommendations to the City Council. All hearings are conducted in accordance with the Rules for Procedures and Robert's Rules of Order. Each case will be called in the order in which it appears on the agenda unless otherwise announced during the meeting. In the interest of maintaining a fair and efficient hearing, the commission adheres to the following steps. Chairperson calls the case. Staff gives a brief report and recommendation. Applicant gives a presentation. Opposition and support gives testimony, generally limited to 3 minutes per speaker. Applicant may give rebuttal, commission discussion, and decision. Anyone wishing to speak must complete a speaker's request form and hand it to the planning assistant on my left. Please be as brief as possible and do not repeat statements already made by others. Anyone wishing to protest the decision of a commission public hearing item must request a second public hearing before the City Council. The request must be submitted in writing to the Planning and Community Development Department within 10 days after the commission's hearings. All commission recommendations on public hearing items move forward to a regular City Council meeting. The City Council will then act on the recommendation of the commission. They may concur with the decision, modify it, or overturn it. We welcome citizens' comments, and as fellow citizens of Peoria, we thank you in advance for your participation. This is going to be the final call to submit speaker request forms. If anyone wishes to speak, please fill out a speaker request form and provide it to the staff seated to my left at the end of the dais. The first thing on our agenda is going to be the consent agenda. The consent agenda is for items that are routine in nature and consist of three items tonight. 1C is the disposition of absence. That's the discussion and possible action to approve, excuse the absences of Commissioners Greg Loper, Sean Hutchinson, and Jeff Nelson at the April 16, 2015 meeting. 2C is the minutes, discussion and possible action to approve the minutes of the Planning and Zoning Commission meeting held on April 16, 2015. And 3C is public hearing regarding conditional use permit at 75th Avenue and Bell Road, CU 14-0021. Do any of the commissioners have any questions or comments?
Madam Chair?
Commissioner Loper?
My only question is this, because I wasn't clear from the staff report. Is this in conjunction with the Five and Diner, or is this a replacement for Five and Diner? And I only ask because I love Five and Diner.
Commissioner Loper.
I don't want to get sidetracked too much.
The Five and Diner will be demolished. A new commercial building will be put in its place with two retail suites and a restaurant suite as well.
Would be appropriate as part of their swan song to bring some food to the commission at our next meeting. That was it.
Do any other commissioners have any questions and or comments? Do I have a motion?
Madam Chair?
Commissioner Loper?
I would move that we approve the consent agenda as presented.
Do I have a second?
I second it.
Thank you, Commissioner Lewis. Please vote. I don't have anything working on here.
It just went silent. Oh.
Thank you. Okay, please vote. Again. Okay, and that passes. Thank you. The first agenda item is 4R, public hearing regarding site plan amendment, Verizon Faux Adela, appeal SP15-005. Staff, please present your report.
Thank you, ma'am. Madam Chairwoman, Commissioners, my name is Lori Deaver. I'm a senior planner with the Planning Department. Tonight, I'll be presenting the staff report for SP15-0005. That is an appeal request for the Verizon PHO Adela site. The applicant on behalf of Verizon is Mike Campbell, Campbell AZ. The proposed use is a stealth communications wireless facility, and it would be located at the community of Grace Lutheran Church that is near 107th Avenue in Pinnacle Peak. The project size of the facility is less than 450 square feet. Just to bring you up to speed on previous actions, because this request before you is slightly different, so I would like to go over those items. A site plan was submitted in March of 2015. It's an administrative process. Staff determined that the facility met the criteria for a permitted principal use and the site plan review criteria. So staff approved the site plan on April 6 of 2015. So the request before you is to consider appeal of staff's decision to approve the stealth wireless communications facility. And I'll go into why it was a site plan application in the first place. We have the process for the city of Peoria. There's a two-prong process, and within the zoning ordinance, wireless communications facilities are regulated by Article 14-3-13. It's actually a specific section with regard to wireless communications facilities. WCFs, as they're kind of the slang language, if you will, or kind of the short-term item, is it's permitted within all zoning districts, and it's either permitted as one of the following: a permitted principal use or a permitted conditional use subject to limitations. Now, depending on the determination made, that actually changes the development process or the next steps that the applicant has to go through. So Article 14-313B is the permitted principal use criteria. If the facility actually meets all of those criteria, they go through a site plan process. If they do not meet that criteria, they may still be considered as an allowed use subject to a conditional use permit process. So let me kind of illustrate that so you can see it better. So the WCF criteria actually looks at the type of facility, the height, setbacks, size of the equipment, signage, parking, minimum separations between the actual facilities. So our first decision point as staff is, does this meet the permitted principal use criteria? If the answer is yes, the process is a site plan review. It's administrative, which means it's a staff review level. According to the regulations in the code, we are required two postcards to be sent out to property owners and registered HOAs within the area. The first is called a notice of application. We will be continuing our review as staff through that process. We receive comments during that process. If we find that they've met the criteria for the site plan review application, we then issue a notice of decision postcard at that point in time. So property owners and registered HOAs are actually notified twice of the application. If an appeal is submitted, those are heard through P&Zs, hence the request before you this evening. If the wireless facility does not meet that permitted principal use criteria, then it could be considered a permitted conditional use. That has a completely different process, one that you may be more familiar with, which is the applicant would submit a conditional use permit. It is heard before Planning and Zoning Commission. There is a typical notice of application postcard sent out to the property owners and registered HOAs. If staff receives opposition during the time frame for a conditional use permit, a neighborhood meeting is then required. If not, it is then scheduled for hearing. We would then go through the typical noticing procedures for public hearing process, which would be the legal ad, the public hearing postcard. In that particular instance, if an appeal is then generated, it would go to city council at that point in time. So the application before you met the permitted principal use criteria, and so that therefore staff determined the next step was a site plan review process or an administrative review of the application. We have criteria within the zoning ordinance in terms of evaluating when we make a determination for a site plan. There's basically three criteria that are within the center of the slide. Is it consistent with the health, safety, and welfare of the community? Is it in harmony with the purpose and intent of the zoning ordinance, the general plan, and the plan for the area? Will it not cause traffic congestion or seriously depreciate surrounding property values? So the department may grant site plan approval, or we can impose conditions to satisfy the provisions of the zoning ordinance. Now let me get into the details of the actual application for the site. So the WCF is located on the south side of the main church building. It's highlighted in the yellow box, generally in this area right here. As I mentioned, the equipment compound is less than 450 square feet in size, and the existing parking is going to be utilized whenever the facility needs to be serviced. No signage is proposed for it. It's considered a stealth application. It's actually a new bell tower being designed to match the church architecture. All cables, antennas, and everything else associated with that bell tower are going to be internal. You will not see it from the outside. The actual antennas are approximately 8 foot tall, and they're mounted on the inside of the structure at about the 56 foot tall level. So maximum height of the bell tower, and I'll show you some elevations here in a minute, it's 65 feet. Now, one note here is the ordinance actually allows church spires and uninhabitable elements, architectural elements, to go up to 100 feet in height. This application, again, the height of the bell tower is only 65 feet. So the applicant has provided photo simulations of what this would look like. And what you're seeing in the first example here is from the northeast corner. If I'm going to point it out, this would be the tower. Moving to the east of the site, this would be the second elevation, the photo sim. Along to the south, this kind of gives you a better example of what the architecture will actually look like. And this would be to the west of the site. So in terms of staff analysis, we've determined that it's an alternate tower structure. It meets the criteria for a permitted principal use, hence the site plan application. The architecture is consistent with the church. The applicant has provided information that there are no other facilities within a 1 mile radius that are viable for a co-location facility. The equipment is less than the 450 square feet requirement. The antennas are hidden from view. There will be no illumination or lighting on the bell tower. Existing parking is being utilized, and there's no signage with the application. So with that, regarding the noticing, I talked about it briefly. The notice of application postcard was sent out after the first submittal was received. At that time, no emails, letters, or phone calls were received in support of the objection. I have an asterisk here. There was a planner, Rick Williams, before he departed the city. He was handling the case at the time. He noted that there was an inquiry from an adjacent property owner. At that point in time, it was an inquiry and for information only. So that's why it's listed as such, that no emails, phone calls, or letters in opposition or support. There was information provided that they were going to reach out for the applicant at that point in time for additional information, but that was the last that staff heard of it at that point. Barring no support or objection, and it met the site plan approval criteria, we sent out a notice of decision postcard. We received the request for appeal within the time frame that is required. In addition, we also received two phone calls in opposition and one email in support after the appeal time frame. Since we did receive that request for appeal, additional notification measures kick in the process. Same notification radius, a public hearing postcard was sent out alerting them to the commission meeting tonight. Newspaper ad was placed, and we also did receive a petition of support for the church members, which should be included within your packet. So let me talk about the appeal process, because this is slightly different. So the request to appeal. The purpose of the site plan appeal process is to allow the applicant or any member of the public the opportunity to appeal. They have three areas to appeal. It's either to appeal the decision to approve or deny a site plan, which is the case this evening. They can appeal a site plan stipulation, or they can appeal an exaction or dedication associated with the site plan. With regard to the appeal process, the Planning and Zoning Commission hears appeals related to items A and B, so the decision to either approve or deny or a site plan stipulation. Now, the commission may approve in whole, part, they can modify or deny the request or continue the appeal. In this case, Planning and Zoning Commission's decision is final. Within the letter included within your packet, the appellant's concerns were, and I'm summarizing right here, that there was a belief that the facility could be located at an alternate location, that the height of the bell tower should complement the existing church more, and there would be a loss of view corridors. She also provided photographs, and those were included in your packet as well. Our staff's response, again, the applicant has provided information that they have evaluated all facilities within a 1 mile radius. No viable facilities were actually available for co-location. The proposal is considered a stealth wireless application. It would be less intrusive compared to other types of applications that would also be allowed within this area. And the applicant is specifically matching the color, finish, and the scalloping on the existing church architecture. The church would be allowed by right to build the bell tower or similar structure up to 100 feet tall, regardless of whether the wireless facility was present or not. So, staff's key findings. The proposed use is a permitted principal use within the general provisions of the zoning ordinance. The facility is developed as an alternative tower and meets all the provisions of the Wireless Communications Facility Code. And the proposed site plan is prepared in accordance with the requirements outlined within the City of Peoria Zoning Ordinance. Staff's recommendation would be to uphold the Planning Division's approval of the case SP15-0005, subject to the conditions stated in the staff report. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Do any of the commissioners have any questions of staff? Commissioner Loper.
One question, at least so far. So because it's a telecommunications facility, that triggered the site plan review in this process. But let's say a church came in and they were just going to do a spire or some kind of architectural feature. Would that be a site plan process in and of itself that could be appealed to us?
Commissioner Loper, members of the commission, within a gray area, it depends, and let me phrase why. It depends on if that bell tower is going to be impacting certain site improvements. If parking is going to be modified, depending on where it is on the site, it may require a site plan amendment. At the very least, it would trigger a design review process. Both of those processes are administrative in nature, so it would be a staff review.
But if it's just design review, is that appealable, or can that be appealed?
Yeah, Commissioner Loper, if it's a site plan amendment or a site plan, it could be appealed to the Planning and Zoning Commission. If it's a design review, it gets appealed to our Design Review Appeals Board. Otherwise, if it's a building permit, it's not appealable.
Right. I guess my question was, is if a church just built a spire and then a year later somebody comes along and says, oh, they'd like to put a stealth facility inside it, would that even involve us? Or could it potentially involve us just like it is tonight?
So Commissioner Loper, so if the spire was existing and then somebody came in a year later and wanted to put a cell tower, so a cell tower is approved either as a site plan or a conditional use permit.
Okay.
So it would still be the same process as we have tonight.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Golden.
Actually, Commissioner Loper asked most of the questions I was going to ask, because that was sort of my thought too, is about, is it before or after, you know, what comes first, the chicken or the egg? So, but the other question, I mean, I actually like this tower concept much better than I would a palm tree or a whatever the other tree is called. Yeah. I mean, at least it seems to fit a little better into the community. You know, I can drive along and, I mean, those other trees just stand out, where this would be part of it. I actually saw one of these up at some cemetery along the 101, and they have one at the cemetery, and I thought, oh, what a great place to put it. I mean, nobody seems to object, you know, so. But listen, thank you. Good work. Thank you.
Commissioner Nelson.
Thank you. I just want some clarification on something. So the zoning ordinance that you cite in the staff report, Lori, states that church spires, belfries, cupolas, mm-hmm. am I pronouncing that right? And domes can be erected to a height of not more than 100 feet. So those are all architectural elements that sit on a roof or atop a main structure. This is a tower that's separate and aside from the church itself. Are we confident, and do you believe that this is covered under the ordinance?
Commissioner Nelson, members of the commission, it's a good question. The items that were listed specifically as examples in there are examples. If there are similar architectural elements, bell towers aren't necessarily on top of a facility. They can sure. be attached to. Traditionally, you'll see other churches that will have bell towers or other architectural elements separated from the actual main building. So this isn't inconsistent with that. It's analogous to
okay.
to that.
So the fact it's a standalone separate structure, this ordinance still allows that to occur. Okay. Thank you. That's what mm-hmm. I needed.
Yes. Commissioner Spryker.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This is probably being picky, okay? But I'm known for that. It just seems to me that the tower itself is without a lot of design thought going into it. I mean, it's same color, it's going to be stuccoed the same, and it's going to be 65 feet tall. But as I look at the pictures, somehow it doesn't complement the church. It's just a tall structure. And my thought was that I don't have any problem with the cell tower going there, but it just seems to me that the tower itself is, proportionally speaking, very tall and very skinny, and it doesn't seem to fit the church itself, in my mind's eye, as it should. Is the design itself fixed so that it can't be changed, so that it integrates more with the level and the width and the height of the church? Thank you, Madam Chair.
Commissioner Spryker, it's a good question. I would like to defer to the applicant in terms of talking about some of the technical requirements as to what is needed for the facility itself. So that may be a better question for the applicant to address at that point.
Okay. Do any other commissioners have any questions? Okay. I've opened the public hearing. Is the applicant present? Do you wish to speak?
Yes.
Please state your name and address for the record.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the Commission. I'm Mike Campbell. My address is 6880 West Antelope Drive in Peoria. I'm here on behalf of Verizon Wireless. First, I'd like to thank staff. Lori Devers did a great job in guiding us through the appeal. and been very helpful through every stage of it. So, as presented to you by Ms. Devers, the facility planned at the Community Grace Church was approved by staff on April 6th under the site plan review process. We held a pre-op meeting prior to that during the submittal. Rick Williams was the planner at the time. You know, we got all the guidance that was necessary and said, this is what you can do or can't do. I've done a few cases here before Peoria, so I understand what the process is. We met the main objection, objective was to minimize the compound area down to 450 square feet. The area that we're working in is kind of small, which guided us towards that to begin with. So that helped us there. And so we went through the site plan process per the ordinance. The 65-foot bell tower is architecturally integrated. Commissioner Stryker asked about that it's kind of plain and is that set. We went small because everybody says all of our structures are too big. And if we would do some more architectural features going up the structure, maybe some other arches. I know there is one shown on that depiction there. On the south face, it's kind of a white arch that's embedded in there. That's not set. I mean, we could do whatever, you know, if staff or if you state, you know, we'd like to see a little more flair to it. But we were going small to keep it small. And honestly, I haven't had a panel at any level tell me that my site is too small.
Yes.
Thank you. I'm not necessarily suggesting that they have a broader base or whatever it is, but you know, most, let's pretend that we're in Italy someplace. Doesn't it seem like that in this this extended 65 feet that there could be some faux windows or something to just kind of dress it up so it appears as though that it's got a circular stairway going up in it or something to that effect, just so that it isn't like a straight banana sticking up in the air.
I understand. Thank you.
Thank you.
The church, the existing church itself, the highest point on that church happens to be near our end where we're going is 36 foot 7 inch tall. That's adjacent to the structure.
Closer to the microphone, please.
Is that better? How's that? Right. Okay. The high point, as I mentioned, the highest point on the church is 36 foot 7 inches tall. That's this, it's close to our end that we're at. So we've got a difference of, you know, 29, 30 feet from the highest point on the church to the highest point on our bell tower. The architect, as we mentioned, utilized the design there, and we went minimal. So that obviously could be embellished. The bell tower does screen, as Ms. Devers noted, screens the antennas 100%. Coax, everything's inside, which is nice. There's nothing sticking out. As we've all seen, antennas and coax clearly visible, but this was a true stealth design. The equipment area is at the base, and it's going to be screened by a wall that is 10 foot, 8 inches tall. Regarding the setback, the location of the facility is approximately 267 feet north of the south property line. We're 330 feet in from the east property line, 311 feet in from the west, and 330 feet in from the north. So we're almost in the middle of this parcel, which was successful when we were looking at this on a having to meet a 2-to-1 setback if we were going to conditional use permit process. The appellant's property is 260 feet east of the church property line, and the bell tower is situated approximately 600 feet east of, west of the appellant's property line. In dealing with the appellant, I did speak with her on two occasions, on April 3rd and April 6th, before the appeal was filed. Staff directed me and asked me to reach out to her, so we did. In the first conversation, we explained the city process and the site design. Because at that point, all the folks in the area only had a postcard saying, we're putting up a 65-foot tower. So in discussing it with the appellant, I ended up sending her a copy of the site plan. And during the conversation on the 3rd, she stated that the design was okay if it would look like it fit the church. Followed up on April 6th, reviewed the information that she had. At that time, she asked about the alternatives in the area. And as they're mentioned in her appeal letter, the fire station location on Lake Pleasant and just south of Pinnacle Peak, and Lake Pleasant Williams, it's off limits. So we can't go there to begin with. City policy precludes commercial carriers from going on first responder emergency services broadcast towers. The other location was the monopalm that's down on 107th Ave, west of 107th Ave on Via Chula. It's approximately 2,400 feet away from the site, completely out of the targeted search ring that the RF engineer wanted to have the site located in. Lori, could you bring up the aerial showing the red outline of the church? I'm sorry, that's not it. It's down to the bottom next. There we go. Okay, the red box around the church property, that's what was issued by Verizon's RF engineering department as the search area. They were very specific where they wanted the site to fill in the gaps that are currently in the network. So I didn't have a whole lot of room to work with. If the church had told me no, the engineer would have had to gone back and redesign something. So. And as you can see, it's vacant to the north. That's now a residential property project under construction. The property to the west is a C2 property, and to the east is the, I think it's an R18 or greater. I mean, it's significant properties to the west, to the east. So, as I mentioned, the monopalm is not even in that picture. It is 2,400 feet away and won't fit the RF engineer's request. Lori, if you could go back up to the second clip there, one more. This shows the current coverage, and I noted on there the Adela site, this PHO Adela, that's the site we're working on. The tan area means there's the coverage is less than adequate, less than the milestone that the Verizon network has as a standard. The blue and the green is, or the yellow, green, and then the blue, those are good. So on the next slide, you'll see with this site on, the extended coverage that now brings. Yes, the people outside that will get coverage. They'll be able to carry a call, but it's the people in the house, in their offices, and wherever, that want to bring up information on their iPad, tablet, notebook, whatever it might be. The data speeds that Verizon requires in their network are not meeting their expectations, so therefore this new site. And the site is put there, is designed here because of consumer complaints. This isn't, hey, let's go spend $500,000 and put up a site. This is because there is an issue, there's a negative area in the Verizon network. So, and this shows a clear improvement with that site going there. If you go to the next slide, this is a location map of the existing Verizon sites within 3 miles. So you can see they're pretty well saturated, but they keep improving it. The market demands are significant to put up more sites because everybody wants to be their system to be faster, better. They want to make the call yesterday, but they haven't even started to make the call. It's just the demand is unbelievable. So you can see the sites that surround this. There looks to be a gap down to the southwest, but that's actually the river bottom. So probably not a whole lot of demand in there. Onto the next item here is you have received copies of the petition from the church. The church reached out and asked their church members, the neighbors that attend, some that don't attend. There's approximately 360 signatures there in support of the tower design and the location. They felt very strongly about this. Yes, they will receive revenue, but they also feel it's an improvement to the church. It gives them kind of a signature point. If you take a minute, we covered the RF maps. One of the things I do want to talk about, because I know the question is going to come up, is whether we could lower this structure. The original RF request, and it's probably towards the bottom on those screens there, the original RF request, the engineer wanted a rad center, that one, yes, of 60 feet. We're already below that. We're at 56 feet right now. So he wanted higher, and based on knowing what the structure would be, the top of the building, top of the bell tower, we were working on 65 feet as a maximum. So He's already settled for 56 foot, and he did email me and tell me, no, I can't go any lower. It would have to be a redesign all over that would impact us. So, the photo sims that you've seen were created by Sino Design Architect. They've done a very good job in representing an accurate depiction of it. I took the pictures with my iPad. It's basically a naked eye photo, which reflects the true vision from the different locations that we took. And in closing, I'm just asking for your support. Allow this site plan approval to stand, and happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Are you in agreement with staff recommendations?
Yes.
Okay. Do any of the commissioners have any questions? And it looks like I have Commissioner Nelson first.
Thank you, Madam Chair. A question for the applicant. Can you tell me a little, by the way, first of all, thank you for addressing the co-location question. That was one of the questions I had. The other question was, how are you screening those antenna arrays? Is there a fabric screen? Is it literally like a drywall board with stucco on the outside and it penetrates that? How's that done?
Commissioner Nelson, members of the commission, it's what we call an RF-friendly material. It's as close to fiberglass as it can get. And it will be almost seamless. They'll bring stucco up to the point where the exterior will be wrapped in this fiberglass material.
And does that material age as well as the stucco around it? Will it discolor? Will it over time become apparent that those are that's something different up there?
The more recent ones obviously are better product than something that may have been done 15, 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. I have seen over the 20 years of doing this, even the fiberglass, the quality stays stays true to color. And yes, the structure could be repainted if it would be needed. But it's pretty solid. And you won't see any antennas. There's nothing that would be visible to the public.
Great, so. Thank you very much.
Sure.
Commissioner Loper, did you have a question?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Two things. What did you say that the setback from the tower is to the south property line?
Commissioner Loper, to the south from the tower is 267 feet.
267 feet.
Yes, through the grass area and the gravel area, yes.
Because my guess, and I'm hoping that I'm going to ask this question of any of the speakers, is that most of the opposition is probably from the south, because that's where the homes are. What consideration was given to placing it on the north end of the building? That's really your entrance. Maybe it would have been out of character or not worked, but on the site itself, this red box that it needs to be in is the church site, so it seems like it could have been placed, maybe other places. Yeah. You want to speak to that at all?
Yes, Commissioner Lippert, yes. First off, the opposition is from the east. I did speak with a gentleman, and I can't recall his name. One of the early inquiries, he's on the south side, he's almost directly south of the tower, and he had questions about, obviously, this postcard, and explained to him what we were doing, and he said, thank you, that's all I needed. Now, as far as the location, I looked at the north side, the church asked us to be on the south side. They thought, if you're driving up and you see this, it looks like the bell tower is rising up out of the church. As simple as that. The east and west sides weren't appropriate, so it's either the front or the back.
Commissioner Hutchinson.
Thank you. The support cables and the infrastructure for the devices, is that going to be routed out and around the property, or is that all self-contained? How is that going to work?
Commissioner Hutchinson, I'm sorry, could you repeat your question?
Support cabling, power. Infrastructure for the antennas, where is that going to be?
Okay, the power is actually right there. To the west of the compound, we actually need to relocate one small transformer. If you could bring up the site plan. The main power, there's a main power transformer that is just on the southwest corner of the church building, And then we will go underground from there over to our facility and then into our compound. The cabling going from the Verizon Electronics, which is all behind the wall, will then go up inside the bell tower, which is also behind the wall. So none of this will be visible to the public.
Commissioner Golden?
Thank you. You know, I drive this road all the time on 107, and I keep thinking there's another communication tower there. Is there on the west side of this of the road?
Commissioner Golden, that you have the monopalm, which is down Chula, sorry, what the name is, west of the Chula, but that's down south of the batch plant. Now, there may be something, a structure on the, where the cement plant is for their own use, but I didn't see any wireless, commercial wireless carriers in the area, and I spent a lot of time driving a neighborhood, so mm-hmm. when I'm trying to find a site. There's nothing to the north of there until you get up to Happy Valley. So I can't picture one that's along there.
Where they have all the...
Turn on your mic.
It should be just south of the church, but on the west side of the road, where's a property that has all the wagons out front, and out in their back corner to the left, there's a tower. I don't know if it's a cell tower or what it is, but it's got to be quarter mile-ish or more away from this site.
Is my only knowledge of one that's over there is the monopalm that's on the back side of the property. It's right up against the riverbed.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's 2,400 feet away from here.
Okay.
So I guess this is my, I'm being naive, I'm sure, but I guess my question to you is, if that tower is there, and I am assuming it's owned by someone other than Verizon.
That's correct.
And do you piggyback ever on each other's towers where you could?
Yes, ma'am, we do.
Yes,
and if it's in the search ring, the target area, yes, it's one of the things we look at doing, yes.
Okay.
But the location of that one did not meet the objectives, the RF, the coverage objectives of the RF engineer. He told me no when I approached him with it.
Okay, fine, thank you. And just a question too for the staff. The petitions that we received tonight, are those from the congregation or are they from the neighborhood?
Commissioner Golden, my understanding is it is from both. It is a mixture, primarily it is a mixture of the church-going individuals that are in Peoria, outside of Peoria. There's also a couple of property owners included in that list as well.
Okay, fine, thank you.
Do any other commissioners have any questions of the applicant? Okay. We have received speaker request forms. I'm going to call you up in no particular order other than when it was handed to me. When you come up, please state your name and address for the record and any comments, and please limit your comments to 3 minutes and try not to repeat too much of what was said before you. The first applicant I have is, the first speaker request form is Vonda Culp. Did I say that right? Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Vonda Culp. I live at 10449 West Pinnacle Peak. My husband and I bought the property more than 23 years ago. We've lived on the property for 19 years. Our home is directly east of the church, and this bell tower, cell tower, is definitely going to impede our view that we have from our fence line. We're up on a butte. We have a little bit of a slant. Or slope. So it's definitely going to impact the view from our property, impact our property values. I did talk to the applicant about co-locating on the palm tree at 109th and Williams. He told me that was out of range, but I find it really funny that you can see this palm tree all the way from like Lake Pleasant Road and Pinnacle Peak, so I don't know how it could possibly be out of range. I proposed to him the cement plant. as another option, because this church is bordered on three sides by residential development. The west side will be future commercial. He didn't want to listen to it. It sounds like everything is just in stone. They have their mind made up. This is what they want to do. The bell tower itself, it's more than one-third higher than the existing structure of the church. It doesn't fit. I mean, drive around town, look at churches with bell towers. They don't stick up 30-plus feet higher than the existing structure. That's pretty much all the comments I have. Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Chair?
Yes,
Commissioner Loper. Question for the speaker. So you do, so you live in one of the parcels, I don't know if you can pull up the zoning map.
To the east, and you have pictures from my backyard in your packet or in the staff report.
Do you share a common property line then with the church site?
I do not, but there's three other people here that do.
So you're in a couple parcels. So, but I guess my question is actually placing it on the north would actually make it worse for you?
Well, not necessarily. I did ask the applicant about moving it, but we're just moving the problem. It affects me from my backyard, but I think that there's going to be other neighbors that will still be impacted by it. It's better suited for the west of 107th Avenue, over by the concrete, the rock crushing plant. It's just not meant to be in a residential area, 65 feet up in the air.
On this map, there's three parcels to the east of it that look like they have a structure on it. Yours is one of those three?
There's two, and ours is the first one to the right or the, yeah, right there. That's
okay.
This. And if you, in your packet, you should have a picture of the church and the two humps that protrude over our fence line from our backyard. And I'm not standing on a gas can or a ladder to take those pictures. Those are at eye level height from our patio.
Any other questions of the speaker? Okay, thank you. I'm sorry. Could you come back to the podium, please? Commissioner Spraker?
Thank you for coming back. Just curious, is it the height of the tower or the tower?
Both. I think the height of the bell tower or the cell tower, I think the cell tower itself can be co-located somewhere else. The height of the bell tower, it doesn't complement the church. As I said, it's up too high. It should be lower. I mean, drive around town, you do not see bell towers that stick 30 feet above an existing structure. It's hideous. It's just awful. And there's other neighbors that are going to be impacted as well. So, you know, it's our view from our backyard. We have a nice view of the white tanks. Yeah, we can see the palm tree too, but it's a little bit away. It's 2,400 feet.
Okay, one more question. If the height of the tower were no higher than the highest point of the church itself, would it still be a problem?
Not for me. I mean, it is what it is at this point. The church is at 36 feet, 7 inches. So if it wasn't any higher than that.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Any other commissioners? Okay, my next speaker is Guy Culp. Please come to the podium and state your name and address for the record, and please limit your comments to things we haven't heard before. Thank you.
My name is Guy Culp, 10449 West Pinnacle Peak. I obviously live with Vonda. I commend Commissioner Spraker. This looks like a smelter sticking up. It's actually thought of after the fact. It is about the revenue, or they wouldn't even be talking about it. There is no other purpose for the church to have this smelter that they're trying to call a bell tower. I don't see any bell in it. I've been by 100 churches that are gorgeous, spirals. There's nothing gorgeous about a square tube coming out of the ground. They put a little arch on the top of it. It's ridiculous. I am a Verizon carrier in my house. I get full 5 bar strength. That palm tree, she said there's nothing within a mile. We're on right now, we can see from our backyard the cell tower at the fire station and the cell tower to the south and west. The gentleman was right where he said it was. It's a palm tree that's 2,400 feet, which is half a mile, not a mile. It's getting ridiculous how many of these pole things we need sticking in the air. And it will depreciate the property value. I mean, who wants to look at a square tube? Commissioner, thank you for your insight on that.
Thank you. The next speaker I have is Marcy Davis. Please come to the podium, state your name and address for the record, and 3 minutes, and limit your comments to things we haven't heard before. Thank you.
I will do my best. Marcy Davies, and I live at 105 West Via Hermosa, which is on the, I'm south of the church, they're north of me, I am against that property line. I am the first home on that red line, actually. If you look at the red line on the east, my house is right there at the corner. Okay. I am not a public speaker. Okay, a couple of things I looked up was how much of a decrease in the property values that this can affect a community. And again, I don't know how many people received postcards, but it seems like the city is only notifying those that are on the property lines. There is a whole community in there that have no idea what's going on. And this is what happened when they were first proposing to build the church, which I understand that they have the right to build on a residential property. And it is still a residential property. No matter how much we want to look at it as a church or a business that pretends to be a church, it's still not a home. When they first built this church, and on the blueprints that we were given, or I was given because I went to many meetings, it was not supposed to be above a 2-story or 30-foot height. They were building this facade shape, and I called and asked them, how high is it? And they said it's actually 46 feet, and that for every foot above the 30 foot, they have to move an additional 1 foot away from our property line. So now they are going up another 30 feet, but I do not see them moving any farther away from my property line. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay. They just stated that they have another option, and that is for their engineer to work this out. So this is not something that is their only option. He stood up here and he said that if this hadn't worked out, he would have had to go back to his engineer. So I think that that is a viable option for him to take that responsibility and let them work it out as a company. And I have no idea if they looked at property values or if our department here has looked at it. But from what I have found, like the Bond and Hugh approximate impact study in 2004 and used an analysis of a little under 10,000 homes and in 10 different suburbs, the study reflected that the close proximity to a cell tower reduced price by 15% average. So by them doing this, they may be accruing revenue for them, but they are taking away our revenue in the home that we have invested in. Bond and Wang, a transaction market-based study of 4,283 homes in 4 suburbs between 84 and 2002 reflected that the close proximity reduced the price between 20.7% and 21%. So I'm done with my time?
Yeah.
Is that what you're telling me? Okay, all right, so as you can tell, I am not for this. I think it is finding loopholes in the laws for residential property, and I don't think that's right.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Do any of the commissioners have any questions of the speaker?
Okay, thank you.
Do you wanna wait till the speakers are done and then we can bring the applicant back up? Okay, my next speaker is Regina Panger? Did I say that right?
It's actually Pangrel.
Pangrel. Oh, that's okay. Thank you.
I'm used to people not pronouncing my name correctly. Good morning. Not even sure how to properly address you. I believe you're the commission. So thank you for allowing me the opportunity to speak. My name is Regina Marie Pangrel. I reside with my husband at 10520 West Villa Hermosa. I also, as my neighbor who was just up here, reside on that fence line property just south of the church. We actually were not even aware of this at all. We did not get the postcard. We were not aware of it until I found out from my realtor that the deal I had in escrow to sell my house fell out of escrow because the realtor for our buyers found out about this Verizon tower going in, contacted the church, was given information about that, and our buyers backed out. That is a perfect example of the detriment to us as property owners. My husband and I purchased this property when we had 5 children living in the home back in 2004. We need to downsize. I can't get rid of my house. I've been trying to sell it for months. I brought with me a photograph that I would like to share with you in color. I also have several white photographs. This is taken from right inside my dining room. This is my view every day I sit down to have dinner. The photographs that the Verizon developer has provided to you do not accurately depict the view that I nor my neighbors have from our backyards. We have a gigantic church sitting basically in our backyard, and now they want to plant this gigantic, ugly structure. So I have this for you, if I may give that to someone. I also have emails from my realtor who forwarded them to me, her communication with the church, and also the buyer's realtor, his communication with the church. This was on April 20th. This was the first we heard about this cell tower thing at all. And I will note that they're trying to pass this off as a bell tower, but by their own admissions in these emails, it's designed to look like a bell tower. It is not a bell tower. To me, that's skirting the law. It's not appropriate. It's not fair. I'm just a mom. I'm just a family. My house is the biggest asset that I own. I'm not Verizon. I'm not a multi-million dollar company. I need to be able to protect this asset that I have. My house first went on the market back in August of last year. I can't even find someone to rent the house because I have this gigantic church already there. No trees. And now they want to plant this. It isn't fair to us as residents. The church is going to gain a profit from this. And there's certainly other places, I agree, where this could be relocated. I will tell you that when we moved into my house, some of my family members, because I had children in college at the time, and we didn't all have the same plan. Some of us had Verizon, some had other plans. Two of my family members, my husband and one of my adult sons, had to change to Verizon because Verizon was the only cell phone service plan that provided us with the utmost coverage. We have never had any problem with coverage having Verizon. Our cell phones charge without any problem at all. My husband did, I didn't want to note, call about this once we became aware of it. He was told by the city that it was pretty much a done deal. There was nothing we could do about it. We could attend this meeting, but the appeal was even really worthless to us as residents. So, thank you.
Thank you. Do any of the commissioners have any questions of the speaker? Thank you.
Thank you. Would you like copies of these emails? No? Okay. Thank you.
Okay. The next speaker request form I have, I cannot read your first name, but the last name is Breeding.
Yes. Good evening. My name is Sybil Breeding, and I couldn't even give you the address there. I do own the lot. Two lots, actually, but they're right on the east of the church. And so they're between the church and the Culp's property. And, you know, I just found out about that, and I'm very unprepared, so I apologize. Nevertheless, I was never contacted by the church or by anyone in that regard. I do not recall getting postcard. Usually I do pay attention to these kind of things when I get them in the mail. So, you know, did I miss it or what else? I'm not sure what happened, but I do not recall receiving the postcard. Vonda, you know, came to my home and warned me about that, about this meeting tonight, just a few days ago. So I'm getting ready to put these lots on the market. And just as the previous speaker, I am a mom. Hopefully this will be a college fund for my kids. I've been invested in these lots a few years ago, and you know, I do intend to sell them. You know, before I opposed, I did want to see what it looks like, and there is no question that it's a big sore. I mean, it's gonna be a huge challenge for me to have these lots on the market, and it is gonna affect my property value with no question. So, you know, I mean, that's pretty much all I have to say, but yes, I'm right directly east of the church. So I do oppose that. Thank you.
Thank you. Does the applicant have a rebuttal or additional comments? Okay. Is the applicant still here? Oh, yes, okay. I can't see him. Thank you.
Sure, thank you. Okay, I do want to address a couple of points. We hear the property value comment made routinely. In the appraisal industry, and I'm not an appraiser, but I do know people in the appraisal industry, on their forms, there's nothing where they decrease the property based on a cell tower unless it is, well, not even unless, they just don't. I mean, we have another project consultant out in the East Valley, and they were pressed hard on the same question. And the appraiser, and I wish I had the letter from him because it does address this, and it says the cell towers are basically an unknown. They don't negatively, they don't improve the property values. It's a null effect. A couple other points that were brought up. You know, we do have this target area. That's where the engineer needs to be to make this complete. There is obvious various opinions as far as where the site should go. This location is good. It fits the area. It fits the guidelines of the city. And I know that there's people who feel otherwise, and that's perfectly acceptable. But when we meet or exceed the requirements of the jurisdiction, we've done a pretty good job in designing it. And if there's some aesthetic improvements we could do to make it more appealing, then we would do that. So, you know, the question came up about the photos and the views from the adjacent neighborhoods. Lori, could you bring up the photo sim page? Do you have the one of the before? From the, let's go with the east, yes. The one above that, yeah. Okay, I'm standing at the southwest corner of the Culp property on the outside with an iCam, or with a iPad, I took that picture. It's not zoomed in. There are photos that you receive from the appellant which show, and actually go to the northeast one, I'm sorry, a little better angle. I'm at the northwest corner of their property in the Pinnacle Peak right-of-way. Yeah, so I'm probably 100 feet north of where those photos were taken, which show the arches on the top of the church closer together. What I'm getting at is the viewpoint taken is significantly different than what the appellant presented, saying how close this church looked. This was taken with an iPad, and you can't reduce the view. It's a very true, accurate. I can't think of the words. It's a true line of sight picture. I did not zoom and I did not back it off. So, anyways, I just want to make a couple points on that. As far as the notifications, the city has their standard distance requirement for notifications. And that's handled by staff and internally. So, you know, I don't. In fact, I didn't get a letter. I didn't get a comment comment card on it. But as the applicant, I don't. But I fully have faith in what the staff would be sending out. They have no reason not to notify everybody, probably in excess of what should be notified. So, other than that, you know, we've gone to our limits. We've designed a site that fits everything that the city requires and asked for your support on this.
Okay. Thank you. I'm going to start. Commissioner Nelson, do you have questions of the applicant? Okay. Who wants to question the applicant first? You did. Commissioner Spraker?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I've got about four questions here. You mentioned in your first presentation.
Awesome. Okay, thank you. You mentioned during your first presentation is that your engineer said he could go down to 56 feet versus 65 feet. Did I understand that correctly or not?
Yes, sir.
6 feet.
Okay, and secondly, we talked previously about if this thing gets through the commission, that would you agree to making it look like a real bell tower, putting architectural features at the top and going up at it on all four sides so that it looks like some thought went into it as opposed to just sticking this thing in the ground?
Yes.
Thirdly, and this is for you, and it's also for the people that live in the area. Could and I know Commissioner Goldman talked about this early on. And that is a palm tree a tower, if you will. I mean, it may not be a bell tower, nor is this, but it would seem to me to at the least fit in with the deserts that we have here, that you know, have the colors and the look and so forth of a palm tree. Now, I don't know if the people in the area would find that any more reasonable or not, but is that something that that you could look at that would meet the technical and communication requirements that you're trying to suffice?
The monopalm does fit our needs as far as the ability for technical situations, yes.
And if that were pleasing to the residents, you'd be willing to change your plans?
When we met with the church, they asked us not to go with a monopalm.
Okay, then that leads me to the fourth question then. So first, let me clarify. You're saying then that as far as the church is concerned, the bell tower at its 56 feet now is acceptable, and they would allow you to do architectural things to dress it up. But a monopole dressed up as a palm tree is not acceptable to the church.
Okay, the overall height of this is 65 feet at the top. The antennas are at 56 feet, just for a point of clarification.
Okay.
The church's preference was a bell tower over a monopalm. I can't speak for the churches whether they would accept the palm tree, but I think in obvious, whether it's a palm tree, top of the monopalm would be 65 feet because the antennas fit inside the fronds head. So we're looking at whether the church gets a site at 65-foot monopalm or a 65-foot bell tower. If we went that route, I don't see that they would object.
Okay, I think that's a question that needs to be asked of the church, because certainly they're a player in this, but it would seem to me that in as much as the church is making an investment of land and they're going to be paid for it, my guess is that there wouldn't be a really strong objection to a different way of putting up the tower. And on one of the earlier pictures that we had here, you showed where the towers were. Could we go to that relative to the church? I think it had a bunch of, yeah. Does this represent the various towers that are available for communications? The yellow symbols, does that represent tower locations?
These are the existing Verizon structures. This makes up the network in that area.
All right, then my question is, in looking at this, it would seem to me there's a bigger void between towers that are to the, let me think here where we are, that would be to the east, to the west, and to the north, there's a bigger void, as opposed to the west and to the one immediately to the east of the proposed tower with the church.
The area to the west is the river bottom that extends almost over to 117th Avenue. And Lori, if you go to the photo, the one above that, the slide, this shows where they're trying to improve the coverage. So they're trying to hit this area with this site.
If you went to the west and you had a full, I don't know, 100-foot tower, this is just an academic question, I'm not saying that you can get that approval, and you put it to the west, would you have all of the improvements for the communications that you're trying to do with this particular application?
The height is not necessarily better. So to go from a, because the established sites around there, it's all interwoven at the 65 top 56 kind of range. So these sites are all interwoven. So if you come in and put up something that's 100 feet tall, that's going to blow past these sites and not integrate into the network like this site is designed.
You know, I don't know anything about, you know, the range of the signals and all that sort of thing, but you know, as more and more towers go up and more of the areas are developed, it's going to get tougher and tougher to get approval for towers because there's like trees going up. And maybe that's the thing we should do is make them look like trees. I don't know. But I think the people who are here have a legitimate a concern. And they've obviously had a concern about looking at the back of the church for a number of years. I do think personally that the tower itself is poorly designed in terms of what it looks like. It has no artistic value to it whatsoever. I don't see other than financially where it enhances the church. But that's one commissioner's opinion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner Nelson, do you still have comments, questions? No? Okay. Does anybody else have any? Commissioner Golden? Yeah.
And Ashley, this is for staff. If I remember correctly, when I came on to the commission a long, long time ago, you gave us some instructions about cell towers, and could you refresh my memory on is there some direction you need to give us, or can you give us some direction?
Madam Chair, members of the Commission, I'll give you some direction relative to the code, and then I'll look to our city attorney relative to federal law, which limits us on the ability to deny cell tower locations. So as Lori spoke in the beginning, cell towers are allowed in all zoning districts in the city, and they're allowed either outright as a permitted use, or they're permitted, provided they meet the guidelines, as a conditional use permit. And in that context, we're allowed to put, we have some discretion to put conditions onto it. When a cell tower comes into the city, we always try to make them co-locate if there is the ability to do that. We don't have the ability to tell a cell tower provider where they should locate their cell tower. We ask them, we try to always try to get them to co-locate if that ability exists. Secondly, we also try to get the cell tower provider to provide us with a stealth facility, try to disguise it as much as possible. Now, what they could do is elect not to provide a stealth facility and just have a regular cell tower facility. That is an option, but that would also be an option that would require a conditional use permit. So when we look at this stealth facility, we try to look at the context of the area to see what is the most appropriate type of stealth facility. I don't believe there are any or many palm trees in the area, so we certainly did not think a palm tree or a monopalm would be appropriate in this desert Sonoran context out in the area. So that wasn't a foreseeable option. So then we went to the, we worked with them on the cell tower, on the bell tower. Now, we certainly would be amenable to working with them on additional enhancements of the cell tower if that would improve the appearance there. But I can turn to the city attorney. There are limitations under the federal law on what we can do in terms of not allowing a cell tower to go into a location.
Members of the commission, that's correct. The Federal Telecommunications Act was enacted by Congress, and it limits the authority of municipalities like us to regulate cell towers. Our current zoning ordinance and the rules that we have for cell towers pretty much complies, it complies with the Federal Telecommunications Act, and what it does, what we've done, for example, is a tower is permitted anywhere. We can get involved in the aesthetics and try to get them to relocate and all those sorts of things. But if there's a gap in coverage, the federal law says that we can't just say, no, you can't have it there. The telecommunication providers have a right to have their systems work. And government like us, municipal governments, cannot stand in the way. We can work with them and see if we can't make it as unobjectionable as possible, but sometimes you can only go so far. But our ordinance complies with the Federal Telecommunications Act, but it's advisable to follow that, because if you run afoul of our ordinance, you're likely going to be running afoul of the Federal Communications Act as well.
Thank you. Are there any other questions of staff or the, yes, Commissioner Lewis?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. I would also recall from years past the discussions that we've had about some of the cell towers and the information that the city attorney had just given us again, we had heard several years back. All that being said, I too can appreciate what everybody is trying to accomplish here. But we have to look at what the greater need is here. We have to look at what the rights are of the church, the rights of Verizon to be able to provide a service for the greater good for the larger community outside there. And I can certainly appreciate the people who live adjacent to that. And I think it's incumbent upon us to take a look at all of the facts involved in this case and make our decision based on that. I think that staff did a great job of working with the applicant on this, on trying to create a balance, if you will, between the concerns of the neighborhood, the needs of Verizon to establish something that's going to be kind of fit in with the surrounding here. And I agree that if the applicant can do something to enhance the look of that tower, to make it look more like a bell tower, to blend more with what the church looks like, I think that would be a great thing that they could do. I personally don't like the monopalms. I don't think it would fit in that area at all. When I looked at the pictures that we had up here earlier, you see the power poles in the background there. I think you can actually see a monopalm in there in one of those photographs from a long distance away. And I think that's more unsightly. I think as this neighborhood develops, if we have a structure in here that fits the architecture of the church, I think in the long run, that's going to fit a lot better in here than having a monopalm or just a straight tower like we've also seen go up in some areas. So I don't know that we have any discretion other than that, but I would say that the idea of keeping it as a bell tower, cell tower, but enhancing it is probably the best way to go. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Spryker, did you have another comment?
Just tailing on, Bill. My question would be, or my thought would be, I guess, that when you enhance it, does it necessarily have to keep the same block form, or can you do something structurally so that it looks good, as well as faux windows, or making it look as though it's an actual bell tower, putting some thought of origination into it and not just sticking something on the side of this rectangle or whatever, cube or whatever it is?
Yes, Commissioner Sparker, I'm looking at the, we have one photo of where we took it from the side, and I'm not sure if you have it there, but there are some, you mentioned windows, they actually did some indentions in the south side of the church that look like windows, that we could utilize something along that same line to where it does enhance it to make it look like it's all part of.
But I'm talking not just where you're going to see it from ground level.
No, I mean, and
people driving in the area are going to be looking at this thing standing up.
Sure.
And while you've got some architectural features close to the bottom, the rest of it is a palette to be painted or something. You know, a question for staff on this. If they're going to redesign, if they agree to redesigning it in terms of perhaps architecture and or art or both, do they have to come back through the here again, or can they just do that through staff?
Madam Chair, members of the commission, if the applicant was, again, the site plan has already been approved, so if the applicant was agreeable to come in and work with staff on making some adjustments to that, we would work with them on doing that. What I would want to caution the commission about is that we're starting to get into the area of design, which is outside of the scope of site plan review, which is to ensure that it meets the setbacks and the height limitations and all that. The design review is outside, really outside the purview of the Planning and Zoning Commission relative to hearing an appeal for a site plan.
Well, I guess my concern is I live here, and I sit on this little commission, but this is my community. And I think that it behooves the city. We've got a beautiful city, and I don't think this is a beautiful tower. And all it is just a tower. So if it meets the technical requirements of Planning and Zoning Department, that's fine. But I still think that it needs to have something that makes it look like there was thought that goes into it, and there are people that live in the area. And I think we have to take the population, the people that are impacted immediately, visually, whether they're driving down the road or they live in the area, we have to consider something for those people as well. I mean, they have as much right, probably in my mind's eye, they probably have more right, in spite of the federal government, pardon me, but they have more right for expecting something to be pleasing to the eye as opposed to just being this object that sticks into the sky.
Commissioner Spreaker, your comments are absolutely well taken. It sounds like the applicant's agreeable to going back and talking with his architect and finding out if there's some adjustments or some enhancements they can make to that, and we're willing to work with them on that.
Fine, thank you.
I am now closing the public hearing. Are there any other comments from the commissioners before we vote?
Madam Chair, a few things, and forgive me because I'll try to make this brief, but a couple of things just globally. One is we don't get a lot of cell tower requests in front of us. And the reason is the staff does an outstanding job of working on co-location. So the ones we get are the ones that kind of just don't fit in the box. And we've only had, I don't even want to say how long I've been on the commission, but I think we've had three or four. And one of those wasn't even anywhere near, it was like a 30-foot height in an entry feature out of Estancia. But they tend to generate some requests for it. But there's an evolution in the market. I've been in the planning profession for way longer than most of you probably have been alive. And I can remember when the first cell phone towers were all 100, 150 feet, and they were these lattice towers, and they were hideous. And now, you know, they get smaller and smaller, but there's more demand for them. Each of us has a smartphone, so it isn't just the phone calls, it's the bandwidth and the ability to stream your Netflix account and to do different things that drives this. And as the city attorney said, we really can't say no to it. There's a need for it, and I rely on people much smarter than me to tell me where the signal works and the signal doesn't. I you know, my own carrier has its issues. That's one of them. And another one is on the notification thing. The notification thing is meant to be an effort to get people involved and to find out about it, and you're here. And so what, you know, everybody tries to do their best to get the notice to you, but the point is to get you to the hearings where it can be discussed. So in that regard, it succeeds. It may not succeed individually perfectly, but the fact is that somebody got it, they told you about it, and they were able to get you here, and now you're a part of the process. So a couple of things. One, we're all aware that the church could do this as a bell tower. You could argue about how it looks without the cell stuff in it, and it could be 100 feet high. And I think in the area of a number of churches that have spires that are at least of this height or somewhat similar, I'm thinking of the LDS Church on the north side of Top Shelf, I'm thinking of the LDS Temple along Pinnacle Peak, I'm thinking of the Calvary Chapel along I-17, little different character, but there are church spires around there, and they could do this and then come in after the fact and do it. I also, and I mean this with all due respect, but the comment about views, and I appreciate that you've been there a long time, but the fact of the matter is there's properties that are adjacent to you that people have a right to develop. And I always get back to the views were best before any of us moved here. And, you know, further to the west, there's a commercial site that's going to develop as something. And I think of, if you looked at Peoria, one of the hottest real estate areas is right around CCV, and I go to CCV, and CCV has those lights that are on 5-6 nights a week, and they have activities going and lots of traffic, and I know some of the commissioners live by it, and yet there are homes going up right and left in that area. So, you know, that whether or not they detract or add to it, I can't argue one way or another to it. I do know that the number of the studies that were cited were, you know, through 2002, 2004. I'd be curious with the newer technologies and the lower heights how that affects property values. But it could, and it appears it may have in your situation. Also, as Chris said, we're not design review. And, you know, what one person thinks looks good, another person thinks doesn't. And I've always been hesitant. I'm not an architect. I could tell you what looks good to me, but we could argue all day and night about whether or not it should. I'm inclined to go along with the staff recommendation on this. However, there are a couple of things that I would like to bring up. One is, I think we're all in agreement, it's an ugly design. It is. It's hideous. And I think you could do a lot more for this structure to make it look good. Now, there's a downside to that. When it's a plain, simple structure like this, in time, you look past it. Mm-hmm. Adding features to it are going to make it something that you look at. You'll look at it because it's new to you. People in the area in time won't. But when you add features to it, it's a double-edged sword. But I'm in favor of kind of what's been talked about, adding some architectural features to it. The other thing, too, is the lady who brought up the picture out her back window. And I recognize it's a zoomed view and it gives enhancements to it because it's really about 200, it's nearly 300 feet away, but it's very visible. It is not outside of the purview of this commission to talk about doing some landscaping buffer treatments along that common property line. And so this is just me, but I'm inclined to actually kick the can down the road, if you will, and continue this to another meeting and allow the applicant to come back with a better design. I'm not saying a no, I'm saying a better design, and to come back in with some kind of landscaping treatment along that south property line. Even the church itself, I'm looking at it, you know, it's got great turf areas, the kids can play, but there's virtually no landscaping treatment along that south end. And I'm not espousing 48 or 36 inch box trees, you know, soldier course, double row or anything like that, but I'd like some thought given to something placed along that boundary that as it matures helps to alleviate some of that view. Because even from this picture we're looking at here, it's a higher site. That pad height, probably by virtue of topography, is higher than the grade of those homes. So it sits up, and it's gonna sit up, the church itself sits up. And it won't take away the view that you see, but it should help break it up some. And so I'm in favor of continuing this, allowing them to come back with something that offers some landscaping treatment along that buffer and some changes to that spire itself or whatever you want to call it. And I'll leave it at that.
Okay, I have a question of staff. Can we do something like that?
Madam Chair, members of the commission, that's certainly within your purview to do that, to continue the case and seek some adjustments to it.
Okay. And question of the applicant, if we were to do that, how do you feel about that?
Agreement with that, okay. With the continuance to the next available commission hearing.
Okay, and I have one more question of our speakers that came up, and I know I'm not going to have you all come up at once, but can you tell us how you would feel about us asking them to do that?
We were just chatting about the additional landscape for the buffer. That would be an agreement, and yes, some additional design changes that we could possibly be involved with and again review. Yes.
Okay. Then do I have a motion from the commission? Oh,
What? Okay. Please. Thank you. It was also brought up about moving it to the northwest corner of their lot, which would be, you know, would also be a great option to look at because that is next to the commercial and then sitting right on Pinnacle Peak. So it moves it farther away from all of our homes. So if it was on the very northwest corner, it would take it even further away from where we are. The other thing I wanted to say, too, that I didn't say before was that the 200 people that signed that petition, they are church members. They are at that church for 2 hours a week. Mm-hmm. We are living in that house all the time. So I don't see any of those two or however many that actually live in the neighborhood, and I don't know how close they are to the property line. I just don't feel like that is a fair thing, even if it is, you know, important for the greater good. I understand needs the cell phone towers, but at our expense is just a very unfriendly thing for the city of Peoria. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I believe in a comment to what you've just said to us, I think the reason the applicant was putting it on that site is it was where the church had wanted it. So I don't know about something like that. I don't know if there's a reason they wanted it on that side or anything.
I mean, it could be because it's at the back of their building and they don't want people driving in and seeing it. But that would also be
our reason why we want it moved further away from us.
Okay, thank you. Staff, do you have anything?
Yeah, Madam Chair, members of the commission, I'm just noting that the next Planning and Zoning Commission meeting is June 18th, and I believe that would afford the applicant enough time to work on some of those changes. We just conferred with the applicant offline. And
okay. Do I have a motion? I do need a motion for this, right? Okay.
Madam Chair, just so I can give clear direction so everybody has the expectation. So the expectation is that you'll look at some of the architecture for it, and you'll look at a landscaping buffer. Me again, thinking just along the south, and that you'll share that information with the people that are in attendance or the people that staff can direct you to. Not expecting everybody to come and hold hands, that'd be awesome, but it's not going to happen when we come back. So I would move that we continue to my case number, that we continue SP15-0005. To the next available Planning Commission meeting, which as of right now is June 18th, but it could be different.
Do I have a second? Oh. Okay, do you want to amend your motion?
Madam Chair, no, I don't want to amend the motion. What I just would want to make sure that you talk with the church about the options. At the end of the day, this is their property. And so we've heard a lot of different options for the tower brought up. I'd like to know that, you know, this works or this doesn't work in their grand scheme. So that was it, but I'll keep the motion as is.
Okay. Do I have a second?
Madam Chair, I'll second it.
Okay, thank you. Can we vote? Okay, that passes. For those of you that are here, please plan on being back on June 18th to hear what's going on. Thank you for coming. The second agenda item is a text amendment. It's 5R, public hearing regarding text amendment, moving truck and trailer rental, and that's TA15-001. Staff, please present your report.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the Commission. As noted, the next item before you is a zoning ordinance text amendment for moving truck and trailer rental. This is a privately initiated text amendment, which means that It has not been put forth by city staff, but rather a private citizen or member of the public has requested this amendment be considered. The applicant in this case is F&R Grand Mini Storage, LLC. For background regarding this text amendment, the amendment will change not just the applicant's property, but is citywide and will affect all properties as discussed in the zoning ordinance. In this case, the applicant has requested an amendment with the purpose of allowing limited numbers of moving trucks for rent in conjunction with mini storage. The existing conditions of the zoning ordinance would provide for moving truck, trailer, and equipment rental as a permitted use in the following zoning districts: the C4 general commercial, C5 regional commercial, PI1, which is planned light industrial, I1 light industrial, and I2 heavy industrial. These are all the more intense zoning districts, non-residential zoning districts within the city. However, mini storage, which is currently a permitted or permitted conditional use in those districts, is also allowed within less intense commercial zoning districts, the PC2 planned community commercial, as well as our most common C2 or intermediate commercial zoning district. The moving truck trailer rental is not currently permitted in PC2 or C2. So there is currently a disconnect between moving truck, trailer, and equipment rental, and where you can have mini storage uses. That is what the applicant was proposing to alter. In staff's analysis of this use, we looked at what the applicant was intending to do. They were intending to allow the mini storage and the moving truck rental to occur in the same location. We saw that this could provide a potential synergy of uses. If a customer of a mini storage, they're frequently moving their belongings and they may need to use a moving truck and could obtain those uses in the same location and not have to go running from a mini storage unit to a rental truck company at another location. While we were considering this change, we also looked to see that there are in other municipalities, home improvement stores that offer the same service, having a moving truck available for rent at the improvement store. Oftentimes, the large items that may be purchased at a home improvement store, if the customer doesn't have a vehicle, they could utilize the moving truck service, rent the vehicle, take their purchases or merchandise home, and again, not needing to run over all over town to procure those two different items. So staff's objective was to supplement the existing regulations for moving truck rental while maintaining appropriate limitations, given that we would be looking at less intense commercial districts, so that we could limit any possible negative impacts on adjacent properties, the aesthetics, etc. A summary of our proposed amendment, we look to see the technical use listing is moving truck, trailer, and equipment rental, and we would make that an accessory use to mini storage, RV, boat, and trailer storage, as well as home improvement stores with or without garden centers within the PC2 and C2 zoning districts, subject to special limitations. As you can see in the illustrations, these are just two examples where the two uses occur and work quite well together. So we saw that, especially with C2 zoning district being our most common commercial district where we do have mini storage facilities located, that this made a lot of sense and would create opportunities for better service to the public as well as to the businesses that are providing or looking to provide these services. Getting to the special limitations, as staff looked at what could be the possible concerns, why don't we already have these uses occurring, why are moving trucks not allowed in the C2 or PC2 zoning district, we thought through all of the potential impacts that occur. So first of all, we did not believe that the moving truck or trailer rental should be occurring on its own. We were looking at something that was limited in scale. It's an accessory use, meaning that there already has to be the mini storage or the home improvement center located on the property, and this is just occurring as an additional accessory or subordinate use. It is just one little piece of the puzzle. We also limited the number of the moving trucks or trailers to 6. This is consistent with what we have. We have small car rental uses that are limited to 6 in commercial districts. So we saw this as a similar type of limitation. That would allow a few of these to be on site, but it would not overwhelm any commercial center. In addition, we placed limitations on where these trucks and trailers could be located on the site. They need to either be fully screened from view, in which case they are not visible from the public right-of-way, or at least 200 feet away from the right-of-way. An example of this would be at some of the larger big box stores. They have very large parking lots and can certainly place these vehicles more than 200 feet away from the right-of-way and be within their parking lot. It is a distance that creates separation from the public and those driving past and allows the use to blend into what may be a fairly large parking area. In addition, if these vehicles are to be stored outside, if they are not fully screened from view and they may be located in a parking lot, they can't occupy required parking spaces. So if a site has only as many parking spaces as are required by the zoning ordinance, they cannot use those spaces to store these vehicles. They're needed for the all of the customers who would be attending the property. In addition, they can't block access lanes. Our goal here was to ensure that we keep our parking lots and circulation patterns functioning well and are not creating clutter or obstructions within the site. As a result of staff's analysis, we believe that the proposed amendment expands business opportunities while identifying compatible, unobtrusive development practices through the limitations that we've placed. In addition, we believe that it is consistent with the general plan goals of promoting compatibility between differing uses, as well as high quality architectural and site development standards. As a result, our recommendation is that the Commission recommend approval of case TA-15-0001 to the City Council. And with that, I'd be happy to take any questions of the Commission.
Do any of the commissioners have any questions of staff? Commissioner Spryker?
Just a couple of questions. In the the layout, there's no reference to the size or tonnage of the trucks and or trailers or both. Mm-hmm. My concern being that if it's a real busy, let's say Home Depot, mm-hmm. and they sell a lot of lumber that they're going to store a truck on site, it might be a short tractor trailer. Mm-hmm. or a long one, and they're going to use that to haul lumber back and forth mm-hmm. for their clients, which if somebody knows how to drive them, fine. If they don't, they may take it anyway. So I would recommend that there'd be descriptions of the tonnage of the truck and or the size of the trailers or something mm-hmm. so that we're talking about the kinds of equipment that the normal pedestrian driver knows how to handle. And then the second thing, as there doesn't seem to be any prohibition or advocacy for fuel on the site for these vehicles, recommending that there would not be any fuel on the site at all, that they would have to use commercial gas stations, if you will, to supply fuel. That's all I have.
Commissioner Golden?
I just had one quick question, and that is, If I was by a moving area, I mean one of these storage areas, mm-hmm. and they all of a sudden got a right to do this, would they have to come to the commission to ask for permission?
Commissioner Golden, that's actually a very good question. The process that we've put in place through the regulations would require either a site plan or site plan amendment. It would not go before the commission. As has been earlier discussed, our site plan approval process is administrative in nature, meaning it is a staff level review. So they would have to come submit an application to the city showing the specific design on their particular site, where things are going to be located, and it would be reviewed for staff for consistency with the other regulations of the zoning ordinance. So it would be reviewed, but not by the commission.
Because it seems to me that, here's where the rub is for me. It seems to me if I was living next door to this mm-hmm. place, And I had already, they'd gone through the approval process and I agreed to it. Now there's a little change in the use. Mm-hmm. And I guess I'd like to see it go back to the public. Some notification that there's a change of use, but maybe that's not the way you do it.
Commissioner Golden, there would be a public notification process through the notice of application or a notice of decision postcard. So there would be notification within the requirements for the site plan process.
Fine. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Commissioner Nelson?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Ms. Sigmund, just a quick question. I'm not so concerned about the big box stores. They have mm-hmm. huge parking lots. Mm-hmm. That 200-foot right-of-way is not going to be a big issue. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of like the True Value hardware mm-hmm. store, 75th and Cactus. Mm-hmm. They're in a strip center, don't have a lot of frontage. Mm-hmm. They can't park in front of other businesses. Mm-hmm. This is going to force them, if they have to screen it, wouldn't mm-hmm. it have to have them park behind the strip center? Now you're between the back of the strip mm-hmm. center and the housing development. You've got mm-hmm. these trucks starting and being shut down and dropped off at night and things like that. Do you envision that being an issue? Would that even be something that we could run into here?
Commissioner Ellison, we did consider that possibility in terms of forcing, possibly forcing vehicles behind a commercial center. However, it would, as you mentioned, need to be fully screened in that case. The city does have certain hours of operation for noise limits. And so similar to the other vehicles, whether it's deliveries, the limitations that may be placed and the orientation of the site in the rear, we do look at those elements in the original site plan, if you've got a commercial site, to ensure that loading areas are positioned to limit impacts on adjacent residential properties. And again, with the site plan process, that still allows us that discretion to ensure that for that particular site, that the orientation and placement is appropriate and would limit impacts.
Can I ask a follow-up?
Yes.
So what we're saying is if we would have an ability to stop it from happening, from those trucks being rented from that location, if we felt it was a burden to those neighbors.
Commissioner Nelson, I wouldn't phrase it in that we would be stopping it from occurring, but we can look at the location and placement to ensure it's appropriate. And there are still requirements for elements such as setbacks. If there is an adjacency to residential, there may have been a buffer requirement. Again, there's a number of factors that would go into the review that would be site specific.
Thank you.
Okay. I do have more of a clarification, because when I see this, I wonder why it wasn't done as just the applicant that wanted it for their location. Why did staff choose to make it as a text amendment? I'm not saying you shouldn't have. I would just like to know why.
Madam Chair, the request was a text amendment.
Oh.
And it was, in order for the applicant to achieve this for their site, they would have to request it for the zoning ordinance as a whole. It would not be possible for site specific.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Do I open a public hearing on a text amendment? Okay. I have opened the public hearing. Is the applicant present? Okay. Do any of the commissioners have any other questions?
Yeah, just a clarification.
Yes.
We said that if the, and I'm kind of piggybacking on the other commissioner's comment about, I'm thinking 107th and Beardsley, you've got that self-storage here at the corner. There's really no place to put a 28-foot U-Haul that wouldn't be mm-hmm. significantly above the wall. So you mentioned screening mm-hmm. the truck, but I mean, you'd have to build a 15, 18, 20-foot wall.
Commissioner Atluski, that's exactly correct. It may be possible that on a particular location that the applicant would have to construct additional screening, walls, heights, in accordance with the screening requirement and the whatever vehicle they're looking to have there. So that is a very possible, depending on the scenario.
So as just to follow up, as a site plan, then mm-hmm. it would come to you, mm-hmm. The city would look at, okay, you need a screen. They're gonna suggest, 10 foot, 12 foot, they're not going to want to put a big wall up. Would that be accepted or would that be rejected by the city?
Commissioner Atluski, that would, it would depend again on the height of the vehicles that they were looking to store. Because we have the full screening requirement, they would have to identify that they were providing sufficient screening. And of course, if they were to lack, that would certainly limit the future vehicles.
Okay, so. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions right now? I'm closing the public hearing. Any more comments before we vote? Do I have a motion? Commissioner Loper?
Madam Chair, I would move that we forward a favorable recommendation to TA-15-0001 as outlined in the staff report. Do we have any specific stipulations or adjustments to it? Do you just want staff to work up some language to?
I think just, yeah, work up the language regarding the tonnage of the trucks or the sizes of the trailers, whatever. I don't know enough about it, so that it's you know, we're not talking about tractor trailers and fuel on the site, if that's appropriate.
So amended.
Okay. Do we need to rephrase that motion?
Commissioner Loper, do you want to take a shot at that?
You sure. Did so well on the last one.
Madam Chair, I would move that we send a favorable recommendation to TA-15-001 to the City Council with, as outlined in the staff report, with two additions as to be drafted by staff. Doesn't need to come back to us. And those would be regarding the size of the vehicles, whether it be by axle or number of wheels or tonnage or something, or size, and also that separate fuel facilities designed to service those vehicles be prohibited. And I'll leave the language up to you.
Madam Chair, yes. Would it be appropriate that we would limit the vehicles to those that do not require a commercial driver's license? Would that be what the commission was looking at?
Yeah, I think that's fair. That's an easy way to do it.
Okay, do I have a second?
I'll second it.
Okay. Thank you, Commissioner Lewis. Okay, please vote. Okay, that has passed unanimously. Thank you. Are there any comments from the public on non-agenda items? I guess not. Up here, we're not public anymore. Okay, seeing there are no comments on non-agenda items, the next one is report from staff.
Madam Chair,
have anything to report?
Yes, Madam Chair, a few items. So I want to introduce, or rather reintroduce you to the good-looking, dapper gentleman to my right. That's Cody Gleason. He's one of our planners. He actually started with the city about, 7 years ago, I believe? He was our planning tech, and then he left us for a few years and went to the city attorney's office, but we stole him back. So he's back with the planning department. So I just want to introduce Cody back to you again. June 18th, again, is our next Planning and Zoning Commission meeting. And then I just wanted, as a third thing, just to wish everybody a happy and safe Memorial Day weekend.
Thank you.
That's all I have.
Do we have any reports from Planning and Zoning Commissioners?
Madam Chair.
Commissioner Lewis?
Yes, okay. Some time ago we got a staff contact list. Could we get an updated one? These are really helpful. They have the emails and phone numbers for staff, and sometimes we need contact. It would be great. Thank you. And I also just would like to make somebody brought it up, I think, at our last meeting about P83, about people are starting to notice it and the signs and all that. And I have to say the same thing. I've had a few of my friends who live in Peoria and one who doesn't live in Peoria who saw those and asked me, what is P83? They've seen the signs, they've been in the area, and so that's working, and I think that's fantastic for the city because it is getting noticed. Those signs really jump out at people, and I've had the opportunity to explain what P83 is to them, and people have taken an interest in it. So I think we're really going in the right direction. If you haven't been down there to see what's going on, it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
It really is very cool. Thank you.
Commissioner Loper?
And I agree with what was just said about P83. Two things. One, on that contact list, if you can say, where'd Rick go?
Sure. Rick Williams went to the city of Avondale.
Okay. Followed Rob.
To join Rob, yes.
And the second thing is
you know, it's a three-day weekend coming up. It worked out for all of us to get there. If at all possible, I would, if you can keep applicants from doing the Thursday before 4th of July or, you know, Thursday before Labor Day, that would be definitely appreciated by at least
completely
me.
Understand.
And I know you try. You try.
Okay, any other comments? Seeing no further, Commissioner Spreker.
Just a question. You mentioned early on when we were talking about this tower and how it looked and architecture and so forth. Isn't there a review someplace in the city where architectural questions are brought up and talked about?
Commissioner Spreker, it is. It's part of the site plan review. We do an architectural design review. However, if there are concerns or an appeal is based on the architecture, it goes to a design review appeals board rather than the Planning and Zoning Commission. So a different body has purview over that aspect.
I'm still learning, so.
Seeing no further business, I call this meeting adjourned.
Well run.